Well, look at her now. Oh, geez, see, she remembers it differently. Do you remember that you told me that you owned me as your confirmation mentor? Okay, see, we have this wonderful relationship. And Anna has been giving her heart to helping to lead Perceptions Worship. So, I want to say thank you. And let all of you know that you're not going to see her every Sunday up here, because she's going to be doing wonderful things, going on with her life, living in Chicago. And so if you get a chance after the service, you might want to give her a hug. So let's tell her thanks now. Now it is time for that early offering, giving with joy. Because of all of you, the ministry is possible.
Let's listen together for a word from God today, again, as we have been many, many Sundays recently, from Luke's account of the Gospel, the 12th chapter, beginning today with the 32nd verse. Jesus says this. He says, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and get alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour." God bless the reading and the hearing of the Word. So if I seem a little lighthearted today, maybe it's because vacation is tomorrow. Around this time, tomorrow morning, quorums will be on our way to Niagara Falls and Toronto. And by the way, for those of you who've been to the falls, and you are concerned for our enjoyment and pleasure, yes, we will be seeing the falls from the Canadian side. Everybody says you've got to see them from the Canadian side. Am I packed? Who says I'm packed? Who says not packed? Who says partway packed? I know you didn't know you were going to get that choice, but y'all are right. Partway. Takes a little while to pack. Packing for vacation is a good opportunity to figure out what you really need and what you really don't need. How full do we want the back of the GMC? Will I wear it or not wear it? Right? Will I use it or not use it? Will I brush or not brush? Okay, I'm going to brush. Will I read it or not? Will we do laundry or will we not do laundry? We're going to go to church where my good friend is pastor on the way back home. What do people wear to church there and what do they not wear? I don't know about you, but I find that vacation is a good opportunity. Once I decide what's going and what isn't, to get away from what isn't, which is most everything we own, is staying right here, because we're not going to need it. Maybe that's why vacation always seems like a little slice of heaven, right? Because it gets you away from all the stuff and all the concern for stuff in which you're usually swimming and sometimes drowning. So Jesus says, do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourself that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. Now, for those among us who prefer that Jesus and the preacher avoid generalities and just tell us what to do and how does this apply to me? Well, here you've got it. Sell your possessions, give to others, end of service. Or at least it could be. It could be if I didn't try so hard to talk in circles long enough to take the edge off of what Jesus says. It could be end of sermon if those of us who are wealthy enough would forsake the urge to say, well, preacher, just tell me, how much do I get to keep? How seriously should I, how literal am I supposed to be here? And then I tell you something and make you feel a little bit better, and then we'd have all missed the point. Sell your possessions and give alms. Problem with preaching from a text like this is that I don't know what to tell you that'll make you feel any better unless you're already low on assets. Otherwise, this text doesn't really feel like good news. It doesn't feel like such good news to me when I had to confess last Sunday that I don't ask for anything for Christmas because I don't need anything. It's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Well, you know, who needs the kingdom? When you already got all this stuff, it's hard to receive a gift when there's really nothing that you need. Aside from this kingdom that Jesus refuses to define but insists that God wants to give us for free, Jesus talks more about letting go of money and possessions and things that tie us down than he talks about anything else. He talks more about letting go of what we cling to than he talks about morals or sex or rules or any of those other things that we would rather Jesus would say. Sell your possessions and give all. Sell your stuff and give things away, which comes right after Jesus tells us to quit worrying about food or clothing and to look at the birds of the air and the flowers of the field and notice how God takes care of all of them. comes right after last week's text with the man who only wanted what was his, only wanted what was coming to him, and Jesus' story about another guy who got everything he ever dreamed of, took exceptionally good care of it, guarded it with his life, and then died. In the words of Daniel Schultz, he died with a full silo and an empty heart. It all reminds me of the rich young ruler who comes along about six more chapters, asking Jesus what he needs to do to have life, and after determining that this young man has followed the religious law meticulously, which would seem like enough, Jesus tells him to go and sell everything he has and to follow him. And he doesn't want to do it. He doesn't do it, in fact. It's the only instance where Jesus offers somebody an invitation to follow, and they won't. And the reason is things. Sell your stuff and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that don't wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. Today it's backpacks. Last Sunday it was toy boxes. Two Sundays in a row that we get to bless something and then send it away. And I want to say clearly that backpacks and school supplies and toy boxes, while being a great thing, are kind of an icon here. They stand for something bigger. They stand for the call to consider just how far we can take less for me and more for somebody else. How far can we take that? How many times? How much? How much? How much? They stand for turning away from those voices that tell us that we want more, and we want more, and we want more, and we need more, and we've got to have more, and we've got to have more, and turning instead in a new direction to follow a leader who's bold enough to tell us to sell our things and to give to others, and doesn't tell us when to stop doing that, where the limits are. The same leader who says right away today, don't be afraid, little flock, God wants to give you. It's God's pleasure to give you. It's God's pleasure to give you the kingdom. Which, if it's any consolation, sounds a lot better to me than a preacher telling you that you ought to be afraid because God wants to take something from you. Don't be afraid, God wants to give you something. This is the same leader who insists that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And we get that backward a lot. I've said this before, I go back to it time and time again. Because we wait and we wait and we wait to get our hearts in the right place, right? To have enough faith, give you enough faith. To get our spiritual house in order, thinking that when we get all that together and right, then we'll be able to let loose with a few more things and a little more money. Just let me get my heart right first. I don't have my heart right. I don't have it right. I don't have it right. I don't have it right. Jesus says, no. He says, let go of your things, and then your heart will follow. Thanks, Jesus. Let go of your things, and then your heart will follow. Let loose with what you work so hard for, what's yours and yours and yours and rightly earned. Let go of that first, and then you'll have more faith, not the other way around. Do not be afraid, little flock. It is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. And I can't tell you what that means. I really can't stand here and define exactly what that means for you. Seems bigger than me and bigger than what I can really conceptualize, bigger than anything that I can tell you in a few words. But it reminds me of what we do every year at Baby Folk Camp. Every afternoon after our high school campers have spent the whole day one-on-one with children with serious emotional and behavior disorders, we sit down in a circle with Baby Folk staff, just a handful of their staff who spend their whole lives every day, every day, every day helping little children who most people don't want to help or don't know what to do with and don't really want anything to do with, and they don't make a lot of money doing it. And so after we talk about other things, we sit there and we say to them, among other things, why do you do that? Why in the world would you do anything? What on earth would possess a person to forsake a more lucrative career, anything, just anything, and instead go to work every day trying to keep these kids from getting any worse than they are, and risking getting cussed at and called names and kicked on, or just plain failing, or going home exhausted every night? Why do you do this? And inevitably, they'll look at us and they'll say something like this. They say, I do it because I love the kids. I do it because I love, we get a couple of you in here that have heard that, right? We do it because we love the kids. I do it because I know they're not bad. They're just different. I do it because there's no place in the world I could go to work and work with the kind of people supportive, caring.